when we're talking about bitcoins or other tokens, we're not talking about any kind of separate stuff. The ledger is a singular and complete document for determining who has what and how they can use it. Hey everyone, this video is sampled from my online course which teaches you tokenomics for fundraising. You'll learn about the fundraising process, key tokenomic concepts, and get a complete spreadsheet model that you'll learn how to use by solving real-world fundraising problems. You can find the link to the full course in the description section below. And if you'd like to support this channel and help me to create more free content, please like, share, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. That's all. Now back to the video. Hi, everyone. I said last time that blockchains are decentralized digital ledgers. So let's start building that up by asking, what is a digital ledger? This is the first of the lectures in this introductory Blockchain 101 chapter. The key points we'll cover today are a review of the functions of a ledger, which are to record business activities and to control them as well. We'll look at how digital ledgers expand the capabilities of recording and control. We'll understand how purely digital values can be represented and controlled only using a digital ledger and nothing else. Finally, we'll review the business value that are provided by these ledgers. So to understand digital ledgers, we first need to understand the old-fashioned ones first. And they've been around for thousands of years. The ancient Sumerians recorded ledgers on clay tablets like the one shown here, which is dated around the year 3000 BCE. And it turns out that accounting actually came before the development of writing. So the earliest simple ledgers were just invented to record transactions. Now, a transaction is just the technical term to describe an exchange or transfer of countable resources. So like this illustration shows, a transaction occurs and then we record it in a ledger. Now, transactions typically refer to exchanges between individuals, but we can extend the concept to account for resource transfers between parts of a larger or more complicated business. The value of simple ledger use is clear. They are a record-keeping device that allows us to preserve data about a series of historical business events, which we can then review later as we need. This allows us to do things like evaluate what happened in the past, plan better for the future, and keep track of our outstanding agreements. So let's look at the system a little more closely, at something that most people won't think about, but that ends up becoming very important to understand blockchain. Now we can see in this image that 4 beetroots are being exchanged for cash. Let's call it a dollar. So after that exchange, the seller has 4 beetroots less and $1 more. We can record this transaction in the ledger, but notice that the exchange happened regardless. That physical fact stands independently of anything that my ledger says. So here, the transactions and ledger entries are independent events. They can happen separately to each other and do not affect each other. But you can also use ledgers in a more active way to decide or control transactional activities. A case familiar to many of you will be how we use a card to withdraw cash from an ATM. Here, a transaction request is submitted. The ledger is examined, or in computing speak, read. We then determine whether the user has sufficient funds. If they don't, the transaction request is declined. And if they do, the transaction request is executed. Take a moment and look at this. It is completely different to what we had before. There is no direct independent path from the transaction request to its execution. The transaction now depends on the state of the ledger, the values that this ledger contains. In this sense, the ledger controls the decision of the outcome for this transaction. And then there's actually one more thing we left out. In the situation where the transaction is approved and executed, we update or write to the ledger to take this latest transaction into account. So notice that this means that we are still using the ledger as a record-keeping device as well. In fact, we have to. If we did not update the ledger for approved transactions, it fails to function as a control for limiting user withdrawals that exceed the amounts they have deposited. Now, I've chosen a modern electronic example here just because it's familiar to you. But none of this actually has to be digital. All we're talking about here is how we use the ledger to organize your business process. And these methods were being used by the earliest banks well before the invention of electricity. So if ledgers can be used as control devices that long ago, what significance does a digital ledger have over a traditional one? Well, the important detail is not that the ledger is electronic or digital, but that these properties make the tracking and control capabilities of a digital ledger much more powerful. Read, write, and decision actions can all take place much faster. Control rules are programmable. That means we can implement more complex logic, it's less error-prone, and it's reliable and repeatable. These apply to both record-keeping and control uses of our ledgers. But the programmability of control probably has the furthest-reaching implications, as we'll see in the case of blockchain. Now, we've taken the historical route to arrive at digital ledgers, so we're probably still thinking of them as something that we use to match the state of the physical world, something that happens outside of the computer. Like in that earlier example, where we were still using a ledger to keep track of beetroot stock and cash holdings. But as more and more of our actions and experiences become mediated by digital systems, there are an increasing number of use cases where there is no physical quantity or state to track. The ledger is just used to track and control quantities that stay inside that very same digital system. And those digital values then regulate and control how we interact with that system. So consider a video game that uses a fictional currency to control what your character can buy within that interactive experience. Now, this currency does not map to anything out there in our physical world in a clear way. All we want from this experience is an interaction with a closed digital system. The game experience is created and controlled by referencing quantities and values that are purely digital. In these cases, you don't need to have two separate things to solve the engineering problem. You don't need to have the ledger and then the coins, as it were. All you need is one single ledger. Now, this is still the case if we're talking about a massive multiplayer online game where thousands of players take part and they're all each on their own independent gameplay journey. Their cash holdings and their gameplay possibilities can all be stored and controlled with one large ledger. This is a subtle and seemingly minor detail, but it gives you the foundation to understand that when we're talking about bitcoins or other tokens, we're not talking about any kind of separate stuff. All we are talking about is just the state of a common shared ledger that tracks how many tokens every user has. The ledger is a singular and complete document for determining who has what and how they can use it. So now we come to discussing the value that digital ledgers bring to business. We don't need to say much here because we already explained what ledgers are mainly by looking at how they are used to add value to businesses. So let's just use this slide to quickly summarize some of those highlights in one place. We use digital ledgers to analyze historical data, plan for the future, keep track of our obligations, and to program and automate complex business logic. And that's it for today. Let's quickly recap what we've covered. We reviewed the functions of a digital ledger to record business activities and to control them. We looked at how digital ledgers in particular expand capabilities for recording and control. We learned how purely digital values are becoming more relevant and how they can be represented and controlled using a digital ledger and nothing else. Finally, we ended up seeing that the value creation from digital ledgers is really broad and important. And that really is it. I look forward to seeing you in the next lecture, where I'll be introducing you to the idea of decentralized ledger control.